Christ according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now, when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Egos to hold back. You say, "No, we've got to get together on this because this is confirmation for Jesus that the path of God is not necessarily going to be smooth, that there may be imprisonment, there may be death coming ahead. And immediately prior to the gospel here today, Jesus experiences his temptation in the desert, which we'll reflect on during Lent, in which, having learned that he was God's son, the devil preceded him with the devil's version of what it would mean to be God's son. And Jesus had to say three no's and say, no, I know what it means to be God's son, and that means to trust, not to be flashy, not to be on top, but to accept even the suffering that comes. So there's this shadow of the cross that Paul talks about in Corinthians, that to those who are perishing, the cross looks absurd and foolish. But to those of us who are being saved, those of us who have come to know Christ, is the power of God, the wisdom of God, that Christ, through apparent failure, through rejection by evil, gets the power of resurrection that does transform this world in a paradoxical way rather than a straight line. And so Jesus comes into this new ministry, going away from danger, going where he's called, because it fulfills what God had planned all along. Like dogs on the place where there was gloom and oppression. Zebulun and Naphtali were areas in northern Galilee. Jesus was born from Nazareth in southern Galilee. And they were the easiest way to invade Israel, to go around the sea, the easiest way for armies. And they experienced great brutality at the hands of the Assyrian Empire in the 700s BCE. And Isaiah is saying it's not going to stay like this. Because when you're invaded, when the troops are marching through, there's a disruption of life, disruption of your economy. People are killed, people are tortured, people disappear, things are burned. Think of the experience of the people of Ukraine over the last year. And you get an idea what it was like to be in Zebulun and Naphtali. This place where there's darkness and oppression, but upon you a light has gone. Which took place in the liberation from the Assyrians in the 8th century BCE, and ultimately fulfilled for Christians in the Savior coming from that very desolate place and going there. And Jesus' first message in that place of gloom and light is, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has drawn near. Repent, the kingdom of heaven has drawn near. Seems odd because the word repent to us usually has a negative connotation. Repent usually means you have to give up the fun stuff you're doing that is kind of naughty, because we grow up thinking about that as kids. And so when I repent, I'm going to have to gossip less, or I'm going to have to take my hand out of the till, or I'm going to have to stop being so snappish with my family, or whatever else it is, I have to let go of my bad habits. And letting go of our bad habits and our bad choices and our sins is certainly part of repentance. But it means much, much more than that. Repent. Think again. If you study French grade, there's always to do it again. Pensez to think. I can't get you to Latin this morning, but in Greek it's metanoia. Meta as in metaphysics. What's beside, beyond what we're used to? Noia, your mind. Go outside your mind. See it differently. These days we call it being woke. That's taken on some connotations of debate, but the idea is to see what's really going on. Don't stay with your blinders on. Really understand, and to understand, that the kingdom of heaven has drawn near, that right here, in the place of darkness, in the place of oppression, the light shines. Start seeing that you don't have to live in the kingdom of oppressions, in the kingdom of materialism, the kingdom of addiction, the kingdom of toxic politics, kingdom of unhappy family. You can live in the kingdom of heaven by repenting, by seeing in a new way all that is possible for you. That's what happened to the gentleman who gave his story the other day. It's what has probably already happened in each of us are here now. And what I've found is repentance is a lifelong journey. Every time I think I've gotten it, I look back 5 years later and realize I didn't have it at all. It's an ongoing cycle of conversion that will only stop the other side of this life. And I always joke that I've already booked an extended stay suite for purgatory, because I'm still going to have a lot to do when it's done. There's going to be a lot to work through that I haven't even started to see yet. But we're called, that repentance becomes a joy because we're free. free from what oppresses us, as that man was free from addiction. We look at Cumberland, we see a place, maybe not unlike Zebulun and Naphtali, a place in the Rust Belt, a place that is a shadow of its former glories. We look at mainline Christian denominations such as our own, the fear of people in pews, with a fading of something. We can feel that land of darkness, that land of oppression. But Jesus says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has drawn near, near to Zebulun and Naphtali, near to Cumberland, near to Emmanuel, which means God with us. That light shines here, and we are called to awaken to it. And the call is illustrated in the way Jesus approaches then his first disciples. They're just going about their business. Fishermen, we kind of over-romanticize their poverty. Chances are they were kind of middle class. I mean, the fishing industry in Galilee in that time, you could invest in boats and get people helping and all that. Zebedee was probably doing okay. But they were about their daily business, minding their own business. And traditionally in ancient Israel, the rabbi, the spiritual teacher, has disciples looking for the teacher, saying, may I please follow you? Jesus cuts around them and says, you, come, follow me. And when follow me means, I will make you fishing for people. We need to taste, let ourselves taste that repentance, that new joy, that conversion, the transformation that comes from knowing Jesus Christ, present in our hearts, present in our community, present in word and sacrament, and allow it to change us. And when we do that, we don't keep it to ourselves, we share. Because there are people who are walking in their own despair, whether it's addiction, or financial problems, or physical or mental health problems, or family difficulties, or loneliness, or whatever else is plaguing them out there, and also in here. We're not immune from the sufferings of this world. None of us is. But we are called to fish, to help those people find the one who sheds light. To leave behind ordinary business and do that. And we do that. I think there's two ways we can go wrong with that. And a lot of people don't want to evangelize because they think of it in terms of proselytism. They think of it in terms of selling Jesus like you're selling a used car. And that you're just trying to do any trick to get someone through the door. And that cheapens it. Or they think of it as kinds of, there are people out there, Christians, who do kind of spiritual mugging, putting a metaphorical gun to someone's head and saying, accept Jesus Christ or burn in hell. I mean, it's like, you know, it's, and with this very twisted idea of what Christ's coming means. We're here to share. What lights us up needs to go out of us to light up others, to spread the light, and to make sure that we're not shed spreading the darkness. Like Peter and Andrew and James and John, to leave behind ordinary business and find those we meet on the streets, in our job workplaces, in our schools, in social circles, in our neighborhoods, in stores where we go to shop. There's people everywhere that need to be fished for. And maybe it's as small as an encouraging smile with a clerk at McDonald's. Maybe it's something bigger, but to see everyone as a human being, to shed the light of Christ, is a gift. And then once they follow, they proceed to go and cure every kind of illness as well as teach. And for Christ, the cures are signs that what he's saying really has power. He can make you better. Did everyone get cured? No, there's still been illnesses. Everyone Jesus cured died eventually. We're not saved from the ordinariness of this life. But when we know Christ, we experience it differently. We experience it as a gateway to life beyond anything we can imagine or know. Embracing the possibility of the cross. Jesus walked to where there was darkness and spread light. That light has come to you and to me. Let us pick up our candles and share them with others. Amen.
the church and in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the end of the earth. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who do not yet believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who live and work in this community, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For a blessing upon all human labor and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be free from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer from refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this congregation, for those who are present, for those who are absent, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart, show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our enemies and those who wish us harm, and for all whom we have injured or offended, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For ourselves, for the forgiveness of our sins, and for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have committed themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for our brother Ray. We pray for you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, and for those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but eternal life, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary and all thy saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our Lord.
To you, O Lord, our God.
Almighty God, to whom our needs are known before we ask, help us to ask only what accords with your will, and those good things which we dare not, or in our blindness cannot ask, grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
She's good. She's good. Yes.
several apologies. I know definitely for Chuck. This morning, Fred Boss and I arrived at the same time at 8 o'clock Mass, and because we arrived at the same time to talk to each other, neither of us thought to unlock the door.
Oh.
We were in here, and I came out here at 8 o'clock and I was alone, and I thought, is that something I said? But it turns out, eventually the Gettys made it in, and Fred was here, but others had come and not been able to get in because we didn't push the little button. This is a learning experience. I also want to apologize to those who are watching the live stream that we didn't start at the beginning. I thought this morning at the tablet here, but distracted setting up between adult forum and this. We're going to have to find a better system for getting these things done, but we'll get there. But apologies to all those affected by all the human error floating around in the air this morning. We have several announcements coming up. Very much enjoying the gatherings we've had so far, where people have come to Emmanuel House and we've had a chance to talk about our faith journeys and our experience at Emmanuel. I'm hoping that's the beginning of conversations, not the end, and find other ways to let us keep sharing informally with each other and building our common fellowship. And it's been wonderful so far, and there's three more. So tomorrow night at 7 at Emmanuel House, Wednesday at 7 p.m., and next Sunday at 1. So those will all in Emmanuel House, and I'm looking forward to seeing those who've signed up. And if you haven't signed yet, the seats are still out there, and you are, of course, welcome just to show up. And we'll have some refreshments and a good conversation. Our annual meeting is coming up on February the 12th. If you're on a committee, all committees are invited to report at the annual meeting, so please be prepared to make a brief report and let Mark and Lori know so the agenda will be correct. There is a special fundraising going on for the Ukrainian-Russian refugee family, husband and wife and child, who have applied for asylum with a very good chance of getting approved. But it's cost $8,500 for their insurer. Their attorney fees, they have no money. Their assets are in Russia, there's an embargo, and they don't yet have work permits, so any work they have to do could be a little bit under the table, but it's hard to get them into good employment, even though they both have professional backgrounds. And we've already raised considerable money toward this goal through the efforts of a number of different churches and individuals within churches. But we are going. There's going to be a benefit concert on, along with a silent auction on Saturday, February 11th at 2 o'clock at St. Paul's Lutheran Church on Smallwood Street. So Saturday, 11th at 2. We've got some great acts lined up, including the FSU Chamber Singers and a number of other performers. And if anyone out there is a performer and would like to be on the roll, let me know. There is contact information here. If you have something you'd like to donate that can be sold with a silent auction, please let me know about that as well. And if you'd like to make finger foods or refreshments at the concert, if you can help with that, please let someone know. If you want to make a direct donation, you can send it to St. Luke's Lutheran Church on Frederick Street. And they're collecting money just marking for Ukrainian Russian refugees, and it will get to the right place. Other stuff, we've begun the adult forum the last two Sundays at 9 o'clock, and we've been having some wonderful conversations, beginning on the topic of the Book of Common Prayer, but kind of going in and around all kinds of things that are related to the life of faith, and I'm enjoying them very much, and that many people will find a way to join. Episcopal 101, I'm thinking of waiting until the Sunday after the annual meeting to start that. It will be after the post 10 a.m. service fellowship that will stay for those who want Episcopal 101. We'll get some sign-up sheets out about that. You are invited to enjoy Emmanuel's, to join, not just enjoy, but join, Emmanuel's Episcopal Choir, alongside professional soloists and instrumentalists, to perform Handel's Messiah on Sunday, April 16th. Singers of all experience levels are welcome, and rehearsals begin on Wednesday, February the 1st, from 7:30 to 8:30, as well as the following Sundays from 1 to 2 p.m. For more information, please contact Reverend Dr. Scott Rieker. And I think that is it. That's all I know. Does anyone else have announcements that I missed? Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. of Israel to be your people. In your words spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil, and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, Church and the author of our salvation. Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. heard the Lord rejoicing in